I'd like to invite you to turn to the book of Acts chapter 21 as we continue in the Word of God. We're going to be following Paul's mission work as it heads into Jerusalem. All right, he's making his way towards Jerusalem to celebrate the many festivities that are there in Jerusalem. But, you know, life isn't always fun and games. How many of you know? Life is not always fun and games. Just when we have fun things planned, we are blindsided by life. Just this last week, one of our dear saints in the Lord, Marge Ward, lost her 43-year-old son of a heart attack. He was just recently married this fall to his bride, Lisa. Pastor Isaac married the two just this fall. And Lisa was my neighbor, and we grew up together, and it was a tragic, tragic loss. And just when we, the church, are talking about all of the great things that God has in store for us, we are dealing with unexpected deaths and all this nonsense, this violence here in the community, where that grabs the attention of us here in the church and of families and individuals. And yet, at the same time, the world keeps moving forward, doesn't it? And how many of you know that things won't slow down for you? The world just keeps on moving forward, and it's up to us to decide whether or not we're going to keep up with it, or we're going to stay back, or we're going to keep in stride with it. Things seem to be moving at a faster pace these days, don't they? With the access to international current events and media and social media, and we know law enforcement is dealing with on-the-spot surveillance of, 10 to 20 people that are all recording a routine traffic stop. Everybody seems to be looking over their shoulder, walking on eggshells, on pins and needles. Teachers in the school systems can't even discipline or call their kids into order for fear that they might be punished, for fear that they would somehow be called out and maybe provoked to some other type of incident. And this world is changing at a rapid pace, at a rapid speed. Imagine what it was like for Paul and his followers who were going on their missionary journeys. It was a lot, slower pace. Nonetheless, they were constantly on the move. Paul was constantly pushing forward, ready to move to the next city. He would go for a period of time. Maybe over the winter he stayed for a couple of months. Then they would push back out to sea, jump on a ship that was headed to the next city, where the missionaries would then be able to go and continue to preach the gospel. Well, by this time in Paul's ministry, the first century church had been established, and churches had been planted all throughout the Mediterranean region. So now Paul is actually, in some of these ways, making his second or third rounds to these cities. His second or third round to see how these churches are doing. That's one of the things that I appreciate about Paul's ministry. He didn't just go and start works and then leave them. No, he would actually follow up with them. Or if he couldn't go there in person, he would send a letter to inquire about their well-being. How many of you know that that's important? Because it showed that he cared. He wasn't just an evangelist. He wasn't just a missionary. He was also a pastor. And I think this aspect of Paul's ministry is vastly overrated and overlooked, underrated and overlooked. Because I think Paul's heart was to see to it that the church had what it needed to succeed and to survive. He believed in the work that Jesus had called him to so much that he wanted to make sure that he safeguarded that work that God was doing. And one of the ways that Paul safeguarded that was by the Word of God and the teaching of the Word of God, and also by instruction. Another was by prayer through the Holy Spirit. Paul entrusted much of God's work into the hands of the Holy Spirit, knowing that if Paul wasn't there in person, the Spirit was going to be there to take care of things. I liked what Brother Adam said towards the end of worship. He said, how many of you got that image? We tried to lean up against that boulder, that rock, and we try to move it, we try to push it, but guess what? The only thing that happens is we injure our back because we can't move that rock. Finally, we say, God, dismantle this rock. Cause an earthquake to move the rock for me. Let's go to the Word. After we had torn ourselves away from them, we put out to sea and sailed straight to Kos. The next day we went to Rhodes and from there to Patara. We found a ship crossing over to Phoenicia, went on board and set sail. After sighting Cyprus and passing to the south of it, we sailed on to Syria. I mean, these guys were on the move. They didn't have a ship of their own. So they're always having to pay the wage or the fare of joining any ship that was moving from place to place. We landed at Tyre, where our ship was to unload its cargo. Finding the disciples there, we stayed with them 7 days. Through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. I want to pause there for a moment. Through the Spirit, the disciples that were there were trying to urge Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. How many of you know that when some of us are in tune with God, He shows us things, not even necessarily pertaining to our own lives, but maybe the lives of other people. He shows us things, speaks to us, and then it's our responsibility to speak to others. How many of you know what I'm talking about? And sometimes we do need to open our mouths. But does it mean that every time that we open our mouth that the person is going to listen to what we have to say? But at least it can be said that we obeyed the Lord, we obeyed God by sharing whatever it was on our heart. Yesterday I had a very difficult conversation with someone who God urged me to speak with. And when I made the phone call, I said, now you have every right to not answer any of the questions that I have, but God has impressed it upon my heart to ask this question, and I want you to know this. It's because I love you. It's because I care. And you're more than welcome to say and let me know if you feel uncomfortable with the question that I ask. I can be very direct. And sometimes I cut right to the chase. And that's just my personality, and that's who God made me to be, and that's how I'm going to be. So please allow me to ask the hard question. And thankfully, the person responded and said, go ahead, you can ask, because I know that you care. You genuinely care about our well-being. I had to ask, otherwise I would be carrying that upon myself. Through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. Let's see what happens here. Verse 5. But when our time was up, we left and continued on our way. What does that mean? That the disciples came to Paul, urged him not to move towards Jerusalem, but Paul looked at his followers and said, hey, it's time to go. And of course, the people that shared with Paul what God had revealed to them, they were saddened and they were troubled at heart, but they also knew that they had to put Paul and his disciples and those people that were with him that were on a mission in the hands of God. We sometimes need to know that though folks may not listen to what we have to say, that if they are also Christ's followers, they are still in the hands of God. And we pray and trust that they are also doing the will of God as they see fit to do. Amen? All the disciples and their wives and children accompanied us out of the city. And there on the beach, we knelt to pray. Oh, that must have been a sight. After saying goodbye to one another, we went aboard the ship and they returned home. We continued our voyage from Tyre and landed at Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and stayed with them for a day. Leaving the next day, we reached Caesarea and stayed at the house of Philip, the evangelist, one of the seven. Any of you guys remember who Philip is or was? He was one of the seven that was chosen to help perform the administration to the compassionate ministry that the church had committed themselves to do when the church that we read about in the beginning of Acts began to grow and multiply by thousands of people at a time. They began to minister to the widows, to the poor. The people in the church began to donate from their resources, and they began to divide it evenly among the people. There were widows or others that were overlooked during the administration of even the daily ration of food. And when the disciples, Peter and the disciples, felt that the work was too much for them and that they needed to continue to preach the word of God so that they were not sidetracked with this other compassionate ministry, which we believe is still the work of God. But the preaching of the word of God is the center, is the core of it all. The preaching of the word of God is what Peter and the disciples believed that they were called to do. And so they said, we need to survey the group of believers that are around here. And let's choose and select and ask the Holy Spirit to guide us to pick seven individuals, seven men that were filled with the Holy Spirit and that were reliable people to be in charge of the administration of the church. That's pretty cool, right? Well, Philip was one of the seven that was chosen along with Stephen. Anybody remember what happened to Stephen? He was stoned not too long after he was selected to be a part of that group of seven. Well, here is Philip, the evangelist, who also shared the gospel. He led an Ethiopian eunuch to Christ, explained the scriptures to him. How many of you remember that? So now we catch up with Philip again here in Caesarea. Verse 9. He had four unmarried daughters who prophesied. Now, if you're the Apostle Paul and you have a whole bunch of young men, some of them unmarried, and they run into Philip the evangelist, I wonder how long they had planned to stay there in Caesarea. I wonder if they were more interested in sitting down with Philip and being discipled by him, or do you think that they were more interested in the four unmarried sisters? I got a chuckle out of that as well. After we had been there a number of days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. So Caesarea is not too far from Jerusalem, and we know Judea is even a little bit further, just it encompassed Jerusalem, but it was a greater region. Judea is like Southern California. Jerusalem is like Los Angeles, for example. So you find Los Angeles within that greater region. So Agabus is a prophet. Anybody know what a prophet is, what a prophet does? What do? They prophesy. There's two types of prophecy. One kind of prophecy, all right, or to prophesy, is where someone actually preaches and speaks the word of God and speaks life into the people of God or into the ears of its listeners. Another kind of prophecy, or to prophesy, is to actually speak a future event and relay a word by God about a person, about a situation. It's actually a gift of the Spirit as well, in which somebody was gifted to be able to foresee. It relates to foreknowledge. So here we have an interesting picture. We have people, a group of folks that encountered Paul and his disciples and said, we've been revealed, we have been spoken to by the Holy Spirit to caution you from going to Jerusalem. Then Paul and his followers encounter Philip the evangelist's four prophesying daughters. And then Agabus, who comes here in verse 10. Coming over to us, he took Paul's belt. He tied his own hands and feet with it and said, the Holy Spirit says, in this way, the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles. Now, this is a very specific word of prophecy that Paul received. It wasn't a general word of prophecy of, you better not go there because something bad is going to happen to you, that kind of word. Some parents have that kind of word for their children. If you hang around, if you walk like a duck and you look like a duck, what? You're a duck. If you keep hanging around with those friends, you're going to find yourself either in jail or dead. That's a general word of prophecy, right? That there is nothing good that's going to come out of this situation you might receive by somebody who's given you a word of prophecy or speaking to you about a situation or your current or your own life. But Agabus comes now, and it's not a general word. It's a very specific word. So now we see that there has been, there's an approach that has met Paul now at the point to where he's going to receive a specific word that's going to show him and reveal to him what will come, what will become of him and what he has to look forward to here. In this way, the Jews of Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles. The Holy Spirit spoke that word to Paul. And what is Paul now to do with that word of prophecy that now met him? He's got two options. Number one, he can receive that word. He can choose to disseminate that word, to understand that word, and then to make a decision to avoid going to Jerusalem if, in fact, he believes God is telling him you need to be cautious for your life. You need to safeguard your life, and I want to keep you out of harm's way. Paul then would receive that word and not go to Jerusalem. And we've been studying in the book of Acts that several times along the way, this kind of warning has come to Paul, or the Holy Spirit has flat out stopped him in his tracks, even when they were on their way to a specific city and said, stop. Don't go any further. Go to a different place. And Paul obeyed, because it was at a point in Paul's ministry where everything was so fresh, it was so new, and yet there was still so much work to do for him. Now, each and every one of us has a specific calling on our lives. Everybody has a different path. Not all of us is going to have the same path in life. Let's see what Paul decides to do. When we heard this, we and the people there pleaded with Paul not to go to Jerusalem. When we read the word we right here, you need to understand that that's Luke writing. He's saying we, us disciples then, were made aware of the gravity or the severity of the situation that Paul was going to find himself in. And we already know that everyone was trying to kill Paul by this time, right? And Paul had kept, he kept finding himself slipping death, avoiding death one way or another, trying to avoid imprisonment as well. Verse 13 and 14 are the operative verses in this text, in which I'd like to commit the remainder of our time to looking at today. Verse 13, then Paul said, why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. When he would not be dissuaded, we gave up and said, the Lord's will be done. If I were to entitle today's message, I would call it, I am ready. I could give it another name too. How many of you know that the struggle is real? The struggle is real. What kind of struggle? The struggle that is found in the heart of an individual, the tension that is found between heaven and earth. When somebody no longer feels that the pull here on earth, down here on earth, is greater than the pull from heaven. How many of you have ever heard somebody say, don't cry for me. I'm at peace. I am ready to go meet the Lord. Why are you crying? God could just take me now. That's where Paul finds himself here in this passage. Everybody else wants to keep Paul around, much like Jesus' disciples tried to keep him. When they came to arrest Jesus, do you remember what the disciples did? Even Jesus himself, he was torn. He found himself caught in between a rock and a hard place. Jesus said, how many swords do we have? Paul found himself in that predicament. The disciples were ready. Boom, Peter sliced off the ear of a soldier. Here, Luke and the other disciples are like, no, no, no. Our job is to protect you, to care for you, Paul, to minister to you, to see to it that the lamp of Israel is not yet put out. How many of you remember that story with King David? To protect the one that God has anointed. But Paul understood. And I believe this was one of the most critical points of Paul's ministry. It's not the preaching anymore of Paul's ministry. It wasn't the conversions of Paul's ministry. It wasn't the going from place to place to place to place, being so driven by God, being so moved and compelled by the Holy Spirit to push on and to not stop. It wasn't so much that anymore. But what was it? It wasn't the pull of earth upon Paul's life and the work that God needed him to do here on earth anymore. What was the greatest pull now on Paul's life? To do the will of God, even if it meant he was to give his life and go and meet the Lord. Paul had to take a deep, long, introspective look at his life and ask the question, am I ready to give my life and be fully aware of what that meant? Not just all of a sudden, you know, spur of the moment, somebody comes in, boom, they take him and they go and stone him without his choosing. Paul had to make up the conscious decision if he was going to go to Jerusalem, having been enlightened by the Holy Spirit on knowing what he was to find there. Paul had to make the decision of whether he was going to go into that bee's nest. He knew that this was a major turning point in his ministry so that others would be able to witness the kind of decision that Paul was about to make. Why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. Man. I think if we skirt around this issue, we as Christians would be robbing ourselves of one of the most important, the most sobering dynamics and realities of the faith. Are we ready? Are we ready to go to whatever length God would call us to go to in our life today for the gospel of Jesus Christ? Verse 15, after this, we got ready and went up to Jerusalem. Some of the disciples from Caesarea accompanied us and brought us to the home of Nason, where we were to stay. He was a man from Cyprus and one of the early disciples. I'm going to come back to this idea of this tension. How do we know when the word that God has called you to, or what God is calling you to do, or God is asking you to do, or bringing you to do, is actually supposed to run contrary to what the Holy Spirit is also showing other believers and Christians? Because there's a conflict right there, isn't there? Because both are in the situation of understanding the importance of doing what God is asking us to do. Sometimes you may find yourself in a predicament where a loved one has said, if I go into a coma, don't keep me on life support. And that's their wishes. And you have to make up the decision. Maybe you're the advanced care directive individual. You're stuck in the middle of having to make a decision to honor the person's wishes who is in that predicament. And then you talking with all the brothers and the sisters and the siblings and the uncles and the aunties and the children, the grandchildren maybe even, about what they want to do. How many of us have ever been through a situation like that? And we're forced to have to make a decision. And ultimately, like we read here in Acts chapter 21, put the beloved in the hands of the Lord. And that could be so hard. Are we making the right decision? Some of the family members may be upset with me if I make this decision. But what Paul was saying here, he's saying, I'm not just taking what you're saying and throwing it to the side and completely just trampling on it. He's saying, I hear you and I understand what God has even revealed to you, but it's just a part of my testimony of what I am going to have to face. Now, let's get one thing straight. None of us in here have ever died. But we have heard that dying could be a very lonely thing. I remember when my father was dying, and he said, I felt so lonely because nobody could go and die with me. Nobody could go with me. It was just me and the Lord, yet I still felt so lonely. That could be a very difficult place to be, even if one is in Christ. Imagine Paul knowing that if this was his lot, if this was the will of God for Paul to be taken into imprisonment, and ultimately Paul did give his life for God. How many of you know that? Paul gave his life for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Sometimes doing what God has called you to do, even as a Christian, can be the most lonely place on earth, knowing that nobody can take the cup that bears your name. I want you to know this. When you chose to serve Jesus, when you chose to follow him, when you chose to walk the path of the believer, you signed up to obey God's will for your life. May you and I be worthy of carrying that burden proudly, with courage, in the face of adversity, when that challenge comes your way. Some of us here have fought cancer. Some of us here have had to make very difficult decisions. Some of us here have had to make the choice, the conscious decision, to move forward with Jesus and not turn our backs on the Lord despite our circumstances. As lonely as we may feel here on earth, you may not have a spouse there by your side any longer. You may have had to raise your children all by yourself. The conscious decision to choose to serve Jesus, though you may feel all alone, though you wish that there was somebody else there that can do it with you, though you wish there was somebody else there that could bear the burden with you, though you wish there was somebody there that could understand what you were going through, guess what? Don't fret. God is with you. Jesus is by your side. The Holy Spirit is here to comfort you. Just as God was with Paul, God will be with you. Just as God the Father was with Jesus, even upon a cross, a criminal's cross, God will be with you as you bear and carry your burden, as you carry your cross for Jesus Christ. I want you to know that Jesus is with you. God will always give you the strength. And brother and sisters, I want you to know this. I bet if it ever came down to it, there are many who are here today who would be ready to meet their maker if we would be put into that kind of situation today. I believe that this is the kind of church that understands what is meant when we have to bear the burden of Jesus Christ and be the example like Paul was for his disciples to show them that when it's time for us to die, whether in the flesh or whether we're going to see the Lord, that guess what? We will die with courage and we will die with Christ. We will die in Christ. Paul was showing yet another wave of disciples what it meant and what it looked like to choose Jesus.
Sing a new song to you, Lord. We sing unto you, Lord. Lift your voice in praise to Jesus. And I will adore you. You gave everything for us. Every single thing. You sacrificed it for us, Lord. And we thank you, God. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the gift of salvation that we have through you, Jesus. If there is anything that you are carrying today, if there is anything that is distracting you from allowing yourself to experience the presence of God, I want to encourage you to just let it go. I want to encourage you to surrender everything before the Lord right now. Surrender your anxiety. Surrender your depression. Surrender your addiction and say, God, I don't want it anymore. I can't take it anymore. I surrender all to you, Lord. Let's take a few seconds to just do that right now. Lord, to be there for you, because he has never left your side. Amen. So I want to encourage you to lift up your hands with me today. And as we sing this song, surrender your all to the Lord and receive from Him today. Receive from Jesus today.